I have a friend, a very bright, articulate woman, and one of the least suspicious people or superstitious people I know. She's going to be 65 this month. And she tells the story of how when she was a little girl, maybe 7 or 8, she was watching one of those cheesy horror shows on TV, black and white, you know, with really bad special effects. And she was sitting cross-legged on the floor in front of the screen with her hands behind her head resting against the couch. When all of a sudden, and maybe it was because she was feeling the hardness of her mandible through the softness of her flesh, connecting in some esoteric way with the show on TV, she had an epiphany. And she thought to herself with a shudder, "There's a skeleton inside me." And to this day, at the age of almost 65, skeletons and the thought of having a skeleton inside her kind of freaks her out. It wasn't the function of the skeleton that scared her. Of course, she liked being able to run and jump and walk. She's very athletic. She still runs a few miles a day. She appreciates the skeleton for that. She was alive, but a skeleton, she realized, is all that's left of you when you die after you've decomposed. The skeleton is all that's left. She faced at a very young age what most of us spend most of our lives trying to ignore, that whether we are healthy or frail, young or old, lonely or loved, there's a skeleton inside us. Death waits inside each of us. And if we choose to, we can trace its contours beneath our flesh. In fact, we are the species from a young age, from the death of your first grandparent or pet cat or dog, that we're going to die, that all things are going to die. Now, when my son was 7, we went through that, you know, little goldfish stage. And the fish we got from Petco were guaranteed to last a week. And none of ours quite made it. So death for him was kind of an exciting thing because we would go to Petco and pick out a new fish, and then he'd look and say, "Next week I'm going to get that one." Because he kind of already knew that they weren't going to last. But we do know that all things are going to die. And so throughout history, civilizations, peoples, clans have tried to make sense of death, of dying, have created stories of what happens when we die. And we celebrate those, many of those, this time of year, right? Last week we had, maybe you had trick-or-treaters coming to your door. Now, interestingly, in Japan, they celebrate that in August. But regardless, civilizations create stories about what happened when we die. Now, the Celtic and Mexican traditions of Samhain and Day of the Dead are a little bit earthier and more embracing of death than many. Rituals both feature a relationship with those who have gone on before us that continues beyond the grave. Death is not seen as something to be feared, but to be embraced with food and presents and conversation, with dancing and bonfires and altars of your dead loved ones. Now, the early Catholic Church created All Saints Day, which is celebrated on November 1st, and All Souls Day, which follows on the 2nd, to celebrate the dead. In not quite as earthy a way, but on All Saints Day, those who are in a liturgical church tradition commemorate all the saints who have attained heaven. And on All Souls Day, which is the very next day, it's a day to pray for those who are in purgatory so that they might one day attain heaven. So all is not lost. Even if you weren't as good a person as you thought you should be, you're in purgatory, your friends can pray you out. It's kind of a speed bump between the faithful followers and death. I mean, I guess probably kind of like us, they want to honor and remember those who have died, but they don't necessarily want to have lunch with them. Like the Celtic and Mexican traditions. And that's the attitude of many of us, I think. It might make us remember our own skeleton helpfully waiting within. Everybody wants to go to heaven, but nobody wants to die. And so when we take that attitude, we miss actually one of the most important reasons why we have so many holidays about death this time of year. This time of year too, and it's not an accident that all of these traditions center or focus around the same time when all around us the earth looks like it's dying, when the trees are letting go of their leaves and becoming barren, and the grass turns brown, and around us it seems as if the earth itself is dying. We miss the opportunity, if we don't take a moment to do so, to reflect on our own deaths. During this time of year, it calls us naturally to think about dying. And yet now, not even the Halloween costumes are so scary. Halloween comes from the Samhain tradition of Ireland, of the Irish pagans, where you would put on death to fool death and thus live another year. And so, you know, back in the day, we were witches or ghosts, or if you were Charlie Brown, you were many-eyed ghost. But now, most of our costumes are superheroes or Disney characters. I saw a Facebook meme that said, here's a Halloween drinking game for you. Every time somebody comes to the door dressed as a character from the Barbie movie, take a shot. We would all be passed out by 6:30 if we did that, because that was a big one this Halloween. We are so far removed from death in our modern times with the advent of antibiotics and modern hospitals and technology that can keep our hearts beating well beyond the years of our ancestors. In his book, Being Mortal, Medicine and What Matters in the End, Atul Gawande, a renowned surgeon, explores the damage done to us when we refuse to see the skeleton within, when our focus becomes breath, not death, whatever we can do to keep breathing. And he focuses on how the medical community, doctors and nurses, they weren't actually taught much about death. They weren't taught much about helping people die. They were taught all about preventing death, right? That's their goal, that their goal is to not let people die. And so rather than accepting, helping folks accept death as inevitable and not the enemy, and we common folk have become complicit in that, in our unwillingness to acknowledge our mortality, we have given our lives over to the medical machine to keep us breathing. Now, Gawande in particular focuses on the elderly and the medical template of nursing homes and machines and medication we use to stave off death. But it's true for all of us, that any of us, life turns on a dime. None of us know the time we have left. And none of us know if and when we will gain entrance to the haunted house of medical procedures and pills. As Gawande writes, the problem with medicine and the institutions it has spawned for the care of the sick and the old is not that they have had an incorrect view of what makes life significant. The problem is they have had almost no view at all at what makes life significant. Medicine's focus, he writes, is narrow. Medical professionals concentrate on the repair of health, not the sustenance of the soul. Yet, he writes, and this is the painful paradox. We have decided that they should be the ones who largely define how we live in our waning days. Now, in part, this is because we run from our own death, but there are consequences to not living with death. Poet Marie Howe's book, What the Living Do, focuses largely in part on the death of her brother from AIDS. And a few weeks ago, it wasn't in my platform notes, but I kind of extemporaneously tried to share a bit of a poem she wrote that I wanted to make sure I got right, so I had the whole poem here. It's called The Last Time. She writes, "The last time we had dinner together in a restaurant with white tablecloths, he leaned forward and took my two hands in his hands and said, 'I'm going to die soon. I want you to know that.' And I said, 'I do.' And he said, 'What surprises me is that you don't.' And I said, 'I do.' And he said, 'What?' And I said, 'Know that you're going to die.' And he said, 'No, I mean that you are.'" She was focused on the death of her 28-year-old brother to AIDS. And I, you know what? Through the U.S. AIDS years, as a lesbian minister, I lost 33 friends to AIDS and did scores of services. And I never once thought that I was going to die. They were, not me, right? Gawande suggests that rather than ignoring death, that there are questions we should ask. Whenever serious sickness or injury strikes and your mind or body breaks down, the vital questions are the same. What is your understanding of the situation and its potential outcomes? What are your fears and what are your hopes? What are the trade-offs you're willing to make and not willing to make? And what is the course of action that best serves this understanding? When we can have that conversation with our loved ones or have that conversation with our own physician, then we can retain autonomy of our own lives. I remember when my dad died of cancer right before his 61st birthday, and here's something that kind of makes me contemplate my own mortality, is that I recently surpassed my dad's age. So he died right before his 61st birthday, and it was right before my 22nd birthday, and he was dying of cancer. We all knew that. And he said, one time I was visiting him, and he said, "I just regret that we never got to go to Norway together." And I said, "Oh, don't be silly, Dad. We'll do that." I completely missed an opportunity to have an important, difficult, meaningful conversation that I think he was trying to start with me, but I was too young to know how to have it. Right? When we can have these difficult conversations, then we can retain autonomy of our own lives and we can honor the autonomy of our loved ones who may be going through something serious. In one example, he cites that a man was going in for surgery that could harm as well as heal. And so he said, so long as he could watch football and eat ice cream, he wanted to live. That was it. So his daughter said that to the surgeon. If he can still watch football and eat ice cream, then please, by all means, try to save his life if something goes wrong. But if those two things would be impaired, do not resuscitate. What be of life is important to you to continue living? And the time to have those conversations is not when death is imminent, but when we're healthy. Just like the time for a prenup is when you're in love, right? Not when you're already fighting. It's when you're healthy and when you're not in a panic. And those choices may change over time. So it's important to continue to have the conversation over and over. In fact, these high holy days of death that we celebrate around this time of year could be the perfect time to ask these questions of ourselves and one another, much as New Year's offers an opportunity to make resolutions on how we want to live. Halloween, Samhain, the Day of the Dead, the days of saints and souls could be the perfect time to make resolutions for how we want to die. Easy. These conversations take courage, They take honoring our relationships with the dead as well as with the living. They take looking in the mirror and seeing our skeleton grinning back at us. This is what being mortal means. When we recognize that one day we will die, we can live in a way that honors each breath, each beat of the heart, and gives us agency over all our days. As Gawande put it, the battle of being mortal is the battle to maintain the integrity of one's life, to avoid becoming so diminished or dissipated or subjugated that who you are becomes disconnected from who you were or who you want to be. And of course, not everyone gets the long notice or the need to access medical care. The victims of the Hamas terrorist attack in Israel did not. The victims of Netanyahu's unrelenting retaliation aren't. None of the victims in the mass shootings in our nation did. No one knows when our own skeleton will tap us on the shoulder and ask to trade places with us. And even entering the medical machine that seeks to extend breath doesn't always lead us to this profound reflection. I had a friend of mine who I have several saved voicemails on my phone. This is kind of a macabre thing I did after my brother's suicide when I realized I didn't have his voice. So now I have the voices of all my siblings and my mom and good friends. When they left me a message, I saved them so that I can always have access to messages of love from them. The one voicemail I have is from a friend of mine who had been diagnosed with pancreatic cancer and in like 2017, and she had done her time in the chemo machinery and all of the medical procedures to extend her life as much as she could. But 14 months later, she had exhausted all efforts and she was dying, and she knew that. And for the last few months, she kept saying to me, "Oh, we need to get together to plan my memorial service." And I would say, "Yeah, just tell me when." Or I'd say to her, "Hey, Deborah, what do you think about getting together to plan your memorial service?" And she kept putting, her still vibrant living self couldn't bear to face the evidence of her death. Then on Tuesday, April 10th, 2018, she left me a message, which I still have, asking if I was free the next Monday to plan her memorial service. And I said, of course. Monday was my day off, but we set the appointment, and I'd been up in the mountains with friends, and as I prepared to go down the mountains, my friend said, "Why did you make an appointment on your day off?" And I said, "She's dying. I don't know how much longer she has." And in fact, while I was driving to the appointment, her husband called me to tell me that an hour before our set appointment, she had died. And I keep that message to remind me, don't put it off. You don't know how much time you have. We don't know the when and how of our deaths, but we do have this day, this moment, this now to make choices. And, you know, in fact, here at New York Society for Ethical Culture, our society president, Liz Singer, just did a very successful three-part course on aspects of aging. So popular, she's getting ready to do it again. That talk about aging and the medical machinery and death. And Richard and I are also planning to offer things regarding aging and death so that we can prepare for our deaths. Although the best way we can prepare for our deaths is to live a good life now. A well-known Catholic monk, Thomas Merton, one day was weeding his garden, and a young monk came up to him and asked very earnestly, "Brother Merton, if you knew you were going to die tomorrow, what would you be doing?" And he said, "This right here," because he lived fully into his life. He had no regrets. And that is what we can do too now, now, to make the decision now to love, to make the decision now to be kind, to make the decision now to take care of our planet, to take care of one another. In memorial services, particularly for those who die young, but I say it often, I say a long life can never be guaranteed, but a good life can. We can guarantee that we live a good life. And that's the work we are called to do, not just seeking a good death, but a good life lived to the end. And then the courage to let it all go, like the autumn leaves. In her poem on Blackwater Pond, Mary Oliver writes, "To live in this world, you must be able to do three things. To live in this world, you must be able to do three things. You must be able to love what is mortal, to hold it against your bones, knowing your own life depends upon it. And when the time comes to let it go, to let it go. And when the time comes to let it go, to let it go." That is what these holidays remind us to do. That is what the trees in their fiery autumn beauty remind us to do. This is what our skeleton tells us to do, to hold on, to live life in every moment to the fullest we can, and when the time comes to let it go, to let it go, to let go of our own cherished lives and the lives of those whom we have loved, to let it all fall into the mystery, which for all of our humanistic thinking, we still don't know. We still don't know. Who knows? But what awaits us is not a dry, brittle bundle of bones, but a transformation into a dragonfly of light dancing on the winds of love.